And welcome to Talk to Expert series. Myself Sumega, and with me I have my colleague Dr. Shweta and whole team of iSTEM present here. Before we start the session, let me brief about iSTEM. iSTEM is a national portal of Government of India for shaping the R&D infrastructures and supports academia and industry to achieve the goal Atmanirbhar Bharat. It holds the database of functioning R&D equipment and facilities from government or private funding, with options to researchers to check the availability and operational status of geographically dispersed facilities and reserve the most suitable one online and paper use through the portal. Digital catalog on iSTEM portal is available with 700 technology and technology products as mandated by Empower Technology Group or ETG, to help academia and industry to decide the thrust areas and use the available indigenous technology and technology products to manufacture the required infrastructure for the society. Develop the R&D map with required and available information and connect the users with various city knowledge and innovation cluster to assist them in achieving the goal. Create the pool of skilled manpower and job opportunities for them in scientific establishment. Today, we have a special speaker, Mr. Hitesh Kumar Sharma. Mr. Hitesh is working as a technical assistant at Material Research Center, MNIT Jaipur. He was nominated and awarded for Bharat Vikas Award 2018 by ISR Bhuvaneshwar, was awarded as a Bright Researcher Award by International Institute of Organized Research in 2018. Now, I would like to hand over the session to Mr. Hitesh. Hitesh? Shweta ma'am, can you just give him the share option?
Yes, I have given the sharing option to the Hitesh. Hitesh, you can please start.
Very good evening to all of you. I would like to say thanks to all the iSTEM members, as well as to Sanjeev Sir, Shailesh Sir, to provide me this opportunity that I can explore some my knowledge and the practical experience about the AFM to all of you. So basically today I will focus here about the AFM, that what kind of information we can capture from the AFM, and what is the working phenomena of AFM as a for the live sample we can also see possible. So I will go to the mainly practical applications, the practical scenario of this AFM in this lecture, a part of the theory part. So let's start first. First, if I talk about the what is AFM? So AFM, atomic force microscopy, that is the main concern is here. Atomic force microscopy is basically a microscopic technique to capture the image or to provide the information about the topographical information of the sample here. So AFM is a little bit different kind of technology as compared to the scanning electron microscope of and transmission electron microscope, because the SEM and TEM, generally, we use the electron beam as a source of incident to strike on the sample, while in the AFM, we use the probe technique. So if we talk about the advantage of this probe technique as compared to the AFM, that is mainly that no need of focusing as compared to the SEM and the TEM. We can align directly cantilever probe or cantilever tip to the laser and do the mapping and the topographic scanning of the sample. So here there is no need of focusing of the electron beam, or there is no need to pass the electron beam or such kind of magnetic lenses. All these kind of things are not necessary in the case of the AFM, as well as it is capable to provide the height information of the sample. That is not possible in the case of the SEM TEM also, because we can measure quickly the height of the sample and the width of any feature of sample we can measure from here. It also provides information after getting a physical feel of the sample surface by the sharp probe. So we can capture the information by touching the surface of the sample with these probes. It is one of the also advantages here. And it also provide a, you can say a resolution in terms of you can say atomic level, we can capture from here, as while in the SEM and TM it is not possible. So number of advantages of AFM is here as compared to the SEM TM. That's why we are opting a AFM for the high resolution imaging to the nanoscale level imaging like this. So another concern of the AFM, if we discuss about as comparison to the another microscopy, is that sample preparation. So sample preparation as compared to the SEM TM, negligible, because in the TM we have to go for the very dedicated sample preparation. Same is in the SEM, we require some of the coating like this, but there is no need of the sample preparation is required. We can directly use the sample, thin film sample or any bulk sample, by creating the thin film of that sample and do the testing of the sample. If we come to the second advantage of the relative cost of this total phenomena of total imaging system, is very cheap as compared to the SEM TM. So SEM has some medium kind of the relative cost, while the TM has a very high costing, relative costing as compared to the AFM. So the number of advantages is also present here as compared to the SEM TM. One of the advantages we can discuss about is the sample environment. So there is no need of any kind of the sample environment is here. While in the SEM and the TM, we required a vacuum environment. So we and the TM, we required a very high vacuum. So in this case, there is no need of the vacuum, but a little bit artifacts are there of the environmental conditions, but it does not affect the sample information as much as compared to the SEM TM. So if we go for the AFM, now I will discuss to you, all of you, about the what is the AFM, what is the parts of the AFM we generally use, and the what is the operation and artifacts we are facing in the AFM. So this is the basic principle of AFM, atopic force microscopy, is here. In this case, we use only a one scanner, that is the PZT scanner. This is the sample. So we generally put the sample over the scanner. The scanner is generally a lead zirconate titanate type of PZT we used in, generally in the AFM. So this is the cantilever based probe. This is a cantilever structure, and this is a cantilever probe. And this cantilever probe generally scan over the sample. And the sample has a different kind of the morphology, and the tip is also moving over the sample. So the layer is continuously, this light beam, or we can say this is a laser beam, is continuously incident over this cantilever beam. So as the cantilever beam is deflected over the sample, so what kind of the laser is coming to the cantilever is detected by this photo detector and capture the information. So these information is we extract in terms of images or the topographical information and use as per purpose. So one of the kind of the feedback is also provide to control, or to, you can say that, the to control the height or a z-axis of the scanner, so that the, there is no damage of the cantilever tip, or we can say that there is no error voltage generate. That's why we use the control feedback loop. I will discuss about it later in the further PPT. So this is the basic phenomena on which the AFM atomic force microscopy works. So this is the simple term. These are four or five things which we use in the AFM instrument. That is, one is the scanner, one is the cantilever tip, one is the cantilever, and another one is the, you can see from here. So this is the basic instrument. This is of our MRC MNIT lab AFM instrument. This is a Bruker multimode 8 AFM. So in this AFM, I will explain you all the parts which are generally used here. So that is, first I will come to the base of this instrument. This is the isolation table. So isolation table, that's why I was talking about the advantage of the AFM, that there is no need of vacuum as compared to the SEM TM. So to make it free from the vibration or atmospheric vibration, we are using this vibration free table or isolation table here, so that the environmental or atmosphere artifacts can be negligible. The second part is this optical illumination lamp to provide the light, so that it can incident on the sample, or we can see the sample or tip through the microscope. So So this is only a light illuminator to provide the light. Now I'll come to the instrument part. If I talk about the instrument part, first this is the first base. This is a solid stone base on which it is provided. And this one, if I come, this is the first part of the AFM, that is the instrument part. It is the electronic assembly which provides all the voltage supply to throughout the system. That means the second one part, third one part, and the fourth one part. It provides the overall supply through this electronic assembly. And this electronic assembly is responsible to control the Z light scanner. That means this control assembly is the control part of this whole instrument, which can control the feedback voltage, feedback control in both horizontal and vertical directions is controlled by this control assembly. Now, if we come to the second part is, you can see in that this part is here. This part provides both horizontal and vertical type of the deflection of the cantilever, and what is the voltage is generated in both horizontal and vertical type, it is displayed here. So the maximum or minimum sum, what is generating during the movement of cantilever, we can see from here. So this is the indicator display for the horizontal vertical deflection of the cantilever, as well as the maximum sum of the cantilever tuned to the laser. Okay, so come to the second of the AFM, you will see this part is the piezoelectric scanner, and this is a very prime part, or you can say the essential part of the AFM. This piezoelectric scanner is a scanner which moves X, Y, and Z direction. This X, Y, Z direction movement of this PZT is responsible for the movement of the sample. So as the sample moves, the movement of the cantilever will also appear, and we can measure the deflection of the cantilever by some of photodiode detection phenomena, and can measure the topographical information or capture the topographical information of the sample. Okay, so this is the one of kind of the scanner. This scanner is basically a PZT scanner, piezoelectric scanner, which is a simple type of the PZT, and as I discussed, this is a lead zirconate titanate PZT material, and this PZT material is completely, you can say, dipoled. It is aligned, all dipoles are aligned in this PZT before assembling in the instrument. So it is behaving very accurate PZT, and the overall resolution of the system is also depend upon this PZT scanner. Because what is the alignment of dipoles are present during the scanning will represent about the resolution. Okay, so because generally we sometimes we do not be using the instrument, and it is in the as it is form, it is placing in the as it is form, so the dipole of the scanner is also diminished. So in that case, you can say the strain coefficient of piezoelectric coefficient of the material is also going to decrease, exponentially decrease, and the resolution is also down in this case. So that's why the PZT scanner should be used continuously until the life expires. Okay, so this is the second part. If I come to the third one part, third part is this part. This is the cantilever holder, as well as the what is the cantilever tip attached to this cantilever holder. If we come here, we will see this is the cantilever holder part. I will also display this cantilever holder in the coming slide. So this cantilever is a holder basically to attach the tip to this cantilever, and this tip is directly attached to the control system. This cantilever holder is directly attached to the control system, which detects the deflection generated due to the scanner movement. The laser portion, the fourth portion of the laser detection method is a laser photodiode. So that laser is also assembled in this chamber, in this part here, and which is tied to this tilted slide. So laser is also assembled here. Cantilever holder is also here, and cantilever tip is also attached here. And this is part is the scanner upper part where we place the sample. So this upper part is a soft magnetic material, and substrate holder is also soft magnetic material type, which attached magnetically to this PZIT scanner top surface. So we place the sample here, and then over the cantilever holder, then cantilever tip to scan this sample, and the laser is coming throughout this source and strike to the sample or probe directly. Okay, and the last and the upper one part is the microscopic part. This is the microscopic part, and this microscope is basically used to see the morphology of the sample or the tip alignment of to the laser or the sample throughout the system, so that we can say that the laser is completely aligned to the tip, and we are completely able to see the morphology of the sample, what is the top morphology of the sample, so that we can scan over the true surface, or we can say clean surface, so that the good morphology can be achieved. So this is the overall scenario of the AFM instrument. And the remaining part, this is the one, this is the controller. So the whole assembly, throughout this electronic assembly is also powered by this controller. And what is the feedback voltage is generated throughout this controller part, this electronic assembly part is attached to this controller. So the overall, this is the, you can say, heart of this AFM. So the overall phenomena of the AFM, what is happening here, a movement of the PZIT scanner, what is the voltage we are applying to the PZIT scanner, so how much the deflection of the PZIT scanner, and the same in the feedback, what is the feedback is provided to the controller system, all things are generated throughout this controller. So this controller is very heartful, powerful tool for this AFM system. So these are the three things. One is the illumination lamp, second one is the complete system, and third one is the controller. These three are the main parts of this AFM system. Throughout, we can do all the mapping or topographic scanning of the sample. And the, all the things what we captured from here is attached to the display, and we can see the morphology of the sample from here. So here, the two things are the main important. One is the PZIT scanner, because all things depend upon the PZIT scanner, that what is the resolution maybe of this scanner, or what is the image we are capturing, how much resolved is this image. It depends upon the PZIT scanner as well as the AFM probe tip or cantilever tip. So these are the two things are important here, what which we are discussing in the next slide. So if we come to the piezoelectric scanner, this piezoelectric scanner is generally a lead zirconium titanate PZIT material, and this material is synthesized in general pattern as another material. These three contents are pressed together and then sintered the material at particular temperature, so that the we can go for the particular strain coefficient what we are expecting in the PZIT. So we create this PZIT material used to create a PZIT scanner, piezoelectric scanner. This PZIT scanner is, as I told you, is responsible for the movement in the X and Y direction. So if I talk about the X and Y direction, so X and Y direction can be easily controlled here. So there is a rotating stage, as I told you, as I show you, there is a rotating stage here. This is the X, this is the Y, and here is the X is also there. So the X and Y rotating stage is here. So we can easily control the X and Y direction of the PZIT. But the Z direction is very important in this case, because the Z direction we cannot control automatically. So that's why the feedback control is provided through Z axis, to the center part of this. Get access to the feedback loop controller. So this, if we talk about this alignment, polarization alignment or dipole alignment of the PZIT material is done before the attachment to the instrument. And if if the dipole impingement is diminishes due to the non-usage of this AFM, then we have to do a alignment or dipole alignment again, so that we can use it in the scanner. So here, if I discuss that if the scanner is not repolled by regular use, a significant fraction of dipoles will begin to randomize, or you can say depolarize or depole. again over a period of time of period of weeks. So that's I'm saying depoling is accelerated markedly. So if the scanner is subjected to the temperature or above 150 degree, we can start to the polling of the dipole moment. Of PZT. This is the structure of the PZT which I told to you. One other thing I want to tell you about the PZT is that this PZT tube, what is the PZT tube we have assembled or we have fabricated, defines the resolution of this AFM. So the length of the tube, what is the diameter of the tube, what is the strain coefficient of this PZT tube is responsible to define the resolution of whole AFM system. So if the, that's why I'm saying, as much as dipole movements within the scanner will be present, then the more resolution will be there. If the dipole movement is diminished, then the resolution will also diminish. So I can say if the dipole movements are not aligned, the scanner has almost no ability to move, or we can say it has a very poor resolution. The movement, or we can say scanning of this PZT scanner is always in the star pattern. In the second figure, if you see this this part, this is the simple star pattern. So the command which we give to the PZT scanner, it always scan in the star pattern. So suppose if we want to take a picture of 2 micron, so we give a command to the scanner of 2 micron, then this whole picture we divide into some of the lines, or you can say some of the parts. So this whole picture is divided in some of the lines, sample lines. You can see these sample lines, and each of the sample lines is divided into the small segments, that is the step size. So we define a pattern, that is the Restall pattern, so that the scanner scan in that Restall pattern. So suppose the scanner start to scan from this part, so it cover a step size what we defined. It is maybe a 0.4 or 0.4 in case of if we are using a 2 micron image. Suppose we divide 0.4 micron step, then we can go from this part and go to the Restall patterning. So the scanning speed in the direction will be high because we have divided a small segment and we can capture of the same size of the snap. But the scanning in the vertical direction will be small because we have to cover all these small segments and then go to the upper direction, then small segment. So we can say the Restall, this Restall pattern always in the trace and retrace pattern, and the trace and retrace pattern should be almost same to each other if we want to get a very good topographical information from the sample. So this scanner always move in the Restall pattern and capture the information what is available from the sample. So this is the one of the important part of the AFM piezoelectric scanner. So this piezoelectric scanner also provides some of the artifacts, some of the drawback of this piezoelectric scanners, of using of these piezoelectric scanners, what is the drawback comes in the image due to this piezoelectric scanner, we will also discuss here. So if we use the poor type of the piezoelectric scanner, or alignment of dipoles are not properly, then what kind of the artifacts are generated due to this piezoelectric scanner, we will discuss here also. So if I come to the second part, that is the AFM probe. The AFM probe is the same in similar way as the PZT scanner. It is also very important part, or you can say a very strong tool of AFM, the cantilever holder, and the whole of the principle, the whole of the working of the AFM depends upon this AFM probe. So in atomic force microscopy, it is not required only sharp tips, but also a cantilever with optimized spring constant should be used, because the lower than the spring constant between the atoms in the solid, which are in the order of the 10 of the or 10 newton per meter, so we have to choose a spring constant according to this. So the spring constant of the cantilever depends upon its shape, its dimension, and material from which it is fabricated. So the spring constant is very important here in case of the probe, because it is a needle. It is like as a needle. So what is the softening of this needle? will depend upon what kind of the mode we are using in the AFM and how much softening is required in the particular mode and how much softening is responsible to capture the good topographical information or morphological information from the system. So if we can say if the thicker and the shorter cantilever tend to be stiffer and have higher resonance frequency, the same the for the you can say that the spring constant of commercially available jo cantilevers range over 4 order of magnitude from thousands of a newton per meter to tens of newtons per meter. So the resonance frequency ranging from few kilohertz to hundreds of kilohertz is necessary to provide high frequency response, or you can say one of the mode is also present here, the non-contact mode, to allow the non-contact AFM operations. So the high frequency cantilevers spring constant is also required so that we can go for the high frequency applications. Similarly, low frequency applications, we also have one of the mode. So low frequency applications we require another type of the spring constant. So the high constant spring constant and the low spring constant, we have a two different working modes. So the AFM probe, the same is very important, and these AFM probes are made of either silicon or silicon nitride, and these probes are fabricated using a photolithographic process. The photolithographic process, we use the bulk micro machining. Bulk micro machining is substitute process. Substitute process means that we have a bulk silicon sample, silicon surface sample, silicon sample, and we go for the depth etching of the silicon wafer and create a pattern by doing a multiple lithography and doing masking patterns and create such type of the needle test shape structure, or you can say AFM probe. Generally, we preferred V-shaped cantilevers because it has a low mechanical resistance to the deflections, or it's the vertical deflections. So two type of the probes we are using, silicon probes and silicon nitride probes. But where we use the silicon probe and where we use silicon nitride probe, it is a main concern. So I'll discuss about it because we have two modes here. One is the contact mode and another one is a non-contact mode we use here. So in which one mode we use the silicon and another mode we use the silicon nitride, and why we use, I'll discuss about in the further slide. So two important parts of the AFM, that is the first is a scanner, another one is the AFM probe. The whole principle, whole working phenomena depend upon these two parts. So now I come to the point of the working rhythm, what I was discussing, that is the two contact mode, these two mode rhythm is here for the AFM working, that is the contact mode. In this contact mode, the cantilever is soft touch to the sample surface. So you can say that the AFM tips make a soft physical contact with the sample surface. That's why the interatomic force between the cantilever and the sample is repulsive. They try to repulse because they are in contact to the each other. So that's why if the sample is touching to the cantilever is touching to the sample surface, so in that case we require a low spring constant, because if the spring constant is high and the cantilever is touching to the sample surface, if the spring constant is high, in that case there may be a chance of the breaking of cantilever. So we required a very soft soft cantilever needle, or you can say a low spring constant, so that the cantilever can be bent easily. So that's why if the cantilever can bend easily, so we can say the spring constant is very low. So if the spring constant is very low, then the force between the sample surface and the tip will be high. So I can say, or we can say, that due to this high force between the sample surface as well as the tip, due to this high surface, we cannot use the contact mode in the soft or elastic materials scanning. So that's why we use the contact mode only in the case of the hard materials, like as the silicon substrate if we are using to scan, glass substrate we are using. So in that case, we can use this contact mode. So this graph is also displaying the same information here. So this is a tip surface distance, and this is a tip surface force. If the distance between the tip and the sample surface is less, like this, so that means they are almost physical touching to the each other. So in that case, a high force is required because they are touching to the each other, and the repulsion is required in that case, so high force is needed. The same thing is can be explained from here. As the tip surface distance is increased, like as in the another mode of AFM, that is the non-contact mode, so the there is a distance between the sample surface as well as the tip of the cantilever, which causes a low force between the tip and surface, tip cantilever tip and the sample surface force. That means the total force will be less as compared to the contact mode AFM. So we can explain also here, because the spring constant required here is not so much low as compared to the contact. So we can use the stiffer or high spring constant as compared to the contact AFM. So if the spring constant K will be high, so the force required between the tip and the surface of the sample will be less. So that's why a reason that the non-contact AFM can be used in the soft, or you can say polymer type materials or elastic materials. So this is a working rhythm of AFM, the another mode, that is a non-contact and tapping mode. So this is the intermediate, you can say third mode is the tapping mode, that is a part of the non-contact mode. In the tapping mode, the cantilever tip is tuned to particular resonance frequency so that it can tap continuously. So like is in the non-contact mode, the tapping mode working principle is also same. But the tapping is done here by doing you can say frequency tuning or vibration tuning to the cantilever tip. So to provide this tuning to this cantilever tip, we attach the another transducer, piezoelectric transducer, to the cantilever. So this is another reason. This is another way which I was explaining you, that why we use the silicon surface and where we use the silicon nitride probe. So you can see here that the non-contact or tapping mode is required a silicon, is required a tip which is also attached to a piezoelectric transducer. So the weight, you can say mass of the spring in the case of the non-contact mode is high. Okay, so the mass is high, so the frequency is automatically lower here. So we can say for the high mass cases, because we required high masses and the spring constant should be low in the case of the tapping. So the mass is high and the spring constant is low. So we can say here in the tapping mode or non-contact mode, we required a silicon nitride, because the weight is increased by doing a transducer, by attaching that PZT transducer over the cantilever tip, cantilever structure. So this is clear that in the non-contact mode or tapping mode, we used a high mass material, and this high mass material is done by doing attaching a PZT transducer over the cantilever. Due to this high mass, spring constant is minimized. This spring constant is minimized. We can say due to the low spring constant, we can generate a high tip and sample surface total force. That's why it can be used in some practical applications of elastic and polymer type material. So vibration, so in one of the term in the vibration of the cantilever, here we provide the vibration of cantilever as I discussed by the piezoelectric transducer. So the cantilever tip is vibrated, cantilever tip tuning to its resonance frequency here is done typically in order of the 100 to 400 kilohertz, and the amplitude of this is a few of tens to hundreds of angstrom. So in tapping, we can create two regions again, that is for the repulsive and that is for the attractive. So which one is we are using here? That is the attractive, because the distance between sample surface and the tip is high, so the attractive van der Waals interaction is there. So this is a two working reason is here. So these two working reasons can be explained in terms of here also. In the first part, you can see this is a sample substrate, and this is a sample substrate is touches during the scanning touches to the sample. So do this as the sample says, this sample is moving throughout the PZT scanner. This tip is continuously doing deflecting over the sample surface, and this laser is continuously aligned to this cantilever. So the deflection of the cantilever, that means the laser is also reflecting. So what is the information, or what is the tip is moving over the sample substrate, we capture this information throughout the detector, that is a photodiode detector is here. So in this case, this is attaching to the sample substrate, while in another case of the non-contact, there is a some of the tens of thousands angstrom distance between the sample surface as well as the cantilever tip, and the phenomena is same. So to provide the to increase the weight or mass, or to provide the tuning to this cantilever, we attach here another piezoelectric material so that it can guide with the oscillation, and the phenomena is same. The laser is coming throughout the here, and as the cantilever tip is deflect, the overall phenomena what is capturing from the sample surface is detected by this photodiode. That is a positional photodetector diode. So we capture the position, what is the position is deflected of this cantilever. We identified this position of this cantilever. So what I explained in terms of the frequency, we can see here for both contact and non-contact mode. So as you can see, the frequency is denoted by the F equals to 1 upon 2 pi root k by m. If the spring constant is low, then the spring constant is low. You can see here, if a spring constant is low, that means the force is high. That means the interaction between the sample surface as well as the tip will be high interaction force. So similarly, if the spring constant is low, then this is high. If the spring constant is high, then this will be low. So that's why the two mode of contact and non-contact mode can be defined, and what kind of the tip or one kind of the material used for the dip can be tip can be explained from this simple calculation. In the both contact and non-contact mode, we define the movement of cantilever tip. This movement of cantilever tip, we can control, or we can provide in two ways. That may be a constant height mode, and another one is a constant force mode. In the constant height mode, the PZLT scanner, that means the feedback loop which we are providing throughout the controller, main controller, is zero is here in this case, and the Z height of PZLT scanner is fixed. So what is the information we are capturing from the surface, either deflecting of the cantilever, is constant, and it is the spatial variation of the cantilever deflection directly. This is a constant height mode. So, but there may be some drawback in this mode. There may be a chance so that there is a damage of the tip also. That's why we are going for the second mode, that is the constant force mode. In the constant force mode, the deflection of the cantilever can be used as a feedback. So the what is the cantilever is deflecting, we capture the output of this cantilever deflection, and feedback loop provides some feedback signal or feedback voltage to the scanner so that it can adjust the height in Z direction according to the sample surface. So we can control the Z axis, Z height of the scanner in this case. That's why it is a more compatible and more useful mode in both, either in the contact or non-contact mode here. So generally, in the all the cases, we use a constant force mode to scan the sample or to capture the topographical information of it. Now the first part of the what I was discussing here, that I will discuss here about totally on the system wise information, that what is the architecture or what is the family of the AFM part, it is completed. What is the kind of probes and what kind of the piezoelectric scanners we use, that is also covered. Now the second part, I will come to the working principle and operation of the AFM. So this structure, or this, you can see this complete diagram, can explain you about the principle as well as the working phenomena of the AFM. So first I will start from here, that is the PZLT scanner. This is the sample which we place over the scanner. This is the cantilever, and this is the cantilever probe. This is the laser diode, and this is a photosensitive photodetector, that is a PSPD. This is the feedback controller, what is the error signal or error voltage generate, we will control from here. And that feedback loop provides some feedback signal to the scanner again to adjust the Z-axis. So if we place the sample here, we can understand all things from here. This is a sample. So first we neutralize all the, you can say all the horizontal and vertical alignment of the laser to the cantilever so that the maximum sum can be obtained. So we align the laser at the center part of the, you can say four quadrant of the photodetector. So the maximum sum or the zero horizontal and vertical deflection is there so that we can say maximum sum is there. So this maximum sum calculation is available on the controller part. Okay, so as we applied some of the signal, suppose we want to scan a 5 micron by 5 micron image. So we applied this signal to the scanner that we want to scan 5 micron by 5 micron image. So the corresponding voltage signal is applied to this scanner, and this scanner, because the PZT scanner, it is start to move. It is start to deflect in the X or Y direction, depending upon the command. So it is start to deflect, that causes the sample over this scanner also move to start. So there is a deflection of the cantilever. So the cantilever deflection according to the sample surface is start. So as the cantilever is deflected, because the laser is continuously aligned, because we before proceeding this overall process, we align the laser to the photodetector. We align this laser to the cantilever so that the maximum voltage can be appeared to the photodetector. So the laser is completely aligned to this cantilever. So what is the deflection of the cantilever over the sample is detected by this laser diode, that is a photodetector diode, and it directly goes to the what is the sum we have initially put on the PSPD detector, then what is generated after deflecting of this cantilever probe. So what is the difference generated in both cases? We apply to this feedback loop. So this is error signal, that is a actual signal minus set point which we have decided before proceeding the sample, that is a 0 0 like in this case. And what is the actual signal generated after deflection of this cantilever is provided as a feedback signal to control the Z axis, to control the Z movement of this scanner, so that we can go throughout the scanning of the sensor. So that's why this error signal is provided to this feedback, this ZR scanner, this Z scanner, this PZT scanner, control what is the error voltage is there, and again start the motion as per the provided command. So this is a simple process. So the same information is also collect. What is the information? Come here. It also collect to the display system, which we perform some data acquisition techniques to display and analyze the topographic information. So this is the simple overall, you can say, working principle, or you can say what is the operation of AFM is defined here. This is a simple. The laser sensing, what we're discussing here, that this is a, if we decide this the PSPD has the four quadrants, so we can explain some of the laser sensing phenomena by based on these four quadrants. In this diagram, we can say in the first diagram, if suppose the cantilever is moving in the Z direction or vertical direction or normal direction, in that case, if the four quadrant is defined in the ABCD quadrant, name as the ABCD, so the maximum laser or incident on the cantilever should be at the center of this A plus B and the C plus D, because it is moving in the up and down directions, or you can say in the vertical directions, though there may be a movement in the up direction or there may be a movement in the Z direction, like see, you can see from here. If it is the original position, then there may be some movement in the up direction and there is some movement in the down direction. So the A plus B in the up direction and the C plus D in the down direction. So the overall force generated is here A plus B in the upper direction and the C plus D in the down direction. So the major maximum deflection, or we can say maximum laser incident on the cantilever, is like in this pattern. I will explain you in the live, you can say in the systems, what kind of the system. This is the pictorial diagram, and I will explain you in the systems profile also. The same thing is here. If the cantilever is moving in the lateral direction or the X direction, so the what is the alignment of the laser in the A plus C direction? If it is the left movement, if B plus D and B plus D direction, if it is the right movement. So the maximum will be the center of A. You can easily understand like this. This is a system image. You can say if we align the laser, if this is the cantilever, this is the complete cantilever, and this is the cantilever probe, and this is a sample surface. It is a very contaminated sample surface. So this is a sample surface, and this is the cantilever, and it is a cantilever probe, and this is the cantilever. So here the laser is completely aligned here. It is in a stationary condition, not in the movement condition, but the laser is completely aligned here. So we can see the corresponding, what is the sum and the deflection of horizontal and vertical we are getting here. The maximum sum is in this case is a 6.62, which is defined for the what kind of tip we are using here. That is a standard for that. Like as here, if we are using a silicon nitride tip, it may be around maybe of up to 7. For the silicon tip, it may be of up to of 3.84 or 4 maximum. So here, tip is completely aligned with the laser. So the sum is maximum and the reflection is 0. When we move the laser, a part of the a side of the this cantilever, you can see this is the laser. You can see a visible, this is the laser. So this is laser. If this laser is not completely aligned to this cantilever probe, so you can say the corresponding images, corresponding output what we are getting, corresponding voltage or sums what we are getting is they are very 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 low. That means what is the information we are getting from the sample surface is not feasible because the no laser is aligned to this cantilever. So if first we would have to try to align this laser to the cantilever probe as with as much as some high sum possible. Okay. So what we discussed here, the AFM working principle and AFM operation move, I will explain in terms of you practical application, practical demonstration type. So this is a practical experience here that I will explain you. So we have some of the part which I already discussed with you, that is one of the scanner, that is one of the cantilever probe, cantilever tip, and the another one here we required here to put the sample. This is a sample holder. In the previous images or previous slide, this is not visible to us because it is a very small part there. So that's why it's a sample holder. So it depends upon what is the size of the scanner top part. We can arrange the substrate holder, or you can say this is cup, according to the what is the top part has the dimension of a scanner. So it is around a 1.3 or 1.4 centimeter square in diameter. Okay, so this is a sample holder, and one of the glass substrate. This is the glass substrate I used here as a you can say a sample, and one of the thin film is coated over this glass substrate, and this glass substrate is glued over the sample substrate holder by some double-sided tape, or you can say a gluing phenomenon, but it may be a insulating. Okay, so this is a flow chart by which we can perform the AFM testing in a practical mode. First, we use the sample holder, and the sample holder should be very clean, not contaminated, because we are going to be fix the sample over the sample holder. So first we clean the sample holder either by using the acetone or trichloroethylene or isopropanol. Then fix the sample on the sample holder as we put here. Then we fit the cantilever probe in the cantilever holder. We have this cantilever holder, as we show you in the last slide also. This cantilever holder has to put cantilever tip on this. So it is a very challenging task in the case of the AFM. This is the first of the challenging tasks, to fix the cantilever tip in the cantilever holder. Because what is the tip is here, we cannot see from our eyes because it is not visible from our eyes. Because the thickness and dimension of this cantilever tip is very low, we cannot see it. So we can see only the cantilever. So this is the cantilever. We can see here, this cantilever is attached here. So to attach this cantilever in this cantilever holder. This proof to this cantilever holder is very challenging because very thinny probe is here, and there may be a chance of breakage if we are mishandled this cantilever and cantilever probe. So this is one of the challenging tasks. First challenging task is here to fix the cantilever or cantilever tip to the cantilever holder. After doing this, we have to focus the microscope so that we can align the laser with probe as well as can see the sample's top surface clearly. And what is the scenario of cantilever tip, laser, and sample top surface? All these three things are completely visible to us or not, and alignment is properly there or not. So this has to be done to us from the microscope. Then after all these things done from the instrument side, this is the instrument side. If we done all these things, then we will try to align the laser to the cantilever tip so that the maximum sum or zero deflection can be achieved. That is the initial point. So we'll try to set the horizontal and vertical deflection position to zero so that we can achieve the maximum sum in this case. After doing this instrument part, this instrument part is over here. There is no need to do something, or there is no need to do anything in the instrument part. These four or five steps we have to do here. After doing all these four or five steps, then we will go to the system software, or you can say the software which is responsible for all the movement of the scanner, all the movement of what is the feedback control throughout the system software. We will go and initialize that software and put some parameters. What is the parameters? I will explain in the further slide, and try to obtain good morphological information from the sample. So these are the basic operation steps of AFM. So in our case, we have a Bruker multimode 8 AFM. So the corresponding software we are using is the Nanoscope, and you can use another software also to open the raw files. So as soon as we open the system software, that is the Nanoscope software in the system, or you can say a PC, the first of the initial screen will be appear like this. This is the nothing screen. This is the initial screen as we open the software. So during the operation, because we have a two or three type of mode, that is the contact mode, non-contact mode, or a tapping mode. So we have to choose that which kind of the mode and which kind of the mode scanning we have to do. And this will depend upon the what kind of the sample you are doing. Testing of which kind of sample you are doing. Suppose if you are doing elastic or the, you can say, polymer samples, then you have to go for the tapping type of tapping mode. And if you are doing a that means hard materials or silicon substrate, glass substrate, then you can use the contact mode as well as a scan assist mode. That is another new mode in the case of the Bruker multimode 8 AFM, and that is like as a contact mode. So contact mode and then scan assist mode, both are almost there. So first, as we initialize, as we start the system software, this is the first screen which will appear in front of us. You can see here, this part, over this part, there is a some of the icons which are representing here. That is, I will not include this because these are all these things are normal icons which are used for the automatic saving of the images, what is the initialization of image, you have to do starting of the image, beginning of the image, all these things. So the main concern part is below this bottom line. This is the also used in the instrument calibration. So instrument calibrations, that means the, what is the scanner calibration is we are doing in there, horizontal or vertical, as well as the Z scanning. These calibration we can do from this part. So I'm not going to this upper part, I'm come to this lower part. In the lower part, in the left part of the column, we will see there is a four or five things. That is the main important parameters which we have to put before starting a scanning process. So here I am using a scan assist mode. That is the one of the contact, like as a contact mode. So here is the six terms. That is the setup, check parameters, engage, scan, ramp, and withdraw. So I will explain one by one what is the five or six parameters. then what is the use of this parameters and these parameters? How can we change these parameters? What is the significant after changing these parameters? I will also explain. This is the display part. What is the image is coming in real time? We can see here in many terms of the windows. Suppose the primary use of this AFM to see the height image. So the height image we can see here. So height image means that at what top part of side we are viewing the sample throughout the, you can say, a cantilever part. The same, the we can choose multiple windows here to see the sample morphology in terms of, like, as a peak force error. Suppose what is the force is applying between the tip and the sample surface, and what about this error or what is the peak force? We can see another window. We can also open another new window in the third, as a third window, and we can see that what is the amplitude error is there. Like said, what is the angle phase there? So we can see a multiple, but the main concern in the AFM image, if we want to see, that is the one is the height image, as well as some people use the phase image also. Okay, this is the real time image during the sample and tip interaction. Okay, so once we align the laser, to this cantilever tip, as I showed you in the last previous images. After aligning the laser to this cantilever tip, this is a sample substrate. After all these three alignments, we can see such type of image. So when we start the scanning, in this case, during the starting of this scanning, this cantilever will start, will also start to move according to the command what we given to this scanner. Suppose we are providing a 5 micron by 5 micron, that means 5 micron in the x direction and the 5 micron in the y direction. So automatically a 5 micron by 5 micron image from the center part. So this center is indicating here, but in the case, because we have reflected here because of the understanding purpose. So because of the center part, in the center part, it will automatically capture the surface area of 5 micron by 5 micron, and the corresponding signals in terms of the voltage will apply to the scanner, and the scanner will deflect in the 5 micron by 5 micron type X and Y direction, and the Z direction, Z movement will be controlled by the feedback loop control. So this will be the initial screen after opening the software. So if I come to the first of the point of the setup, you will see such type of the image. The setup will require to which probe which we are using in the scan assist mode, because every mode has their dedicated AFM probe. Because I told you that which silicon nitride tip we are using or silicon tip we are using. So it will depend upon the mode. So which mode we are using. Because the spring constant we required in the, what is the spring constant we required in the contact mode AFM is very less. Same in the non-contact or tapping mode, it is high. So according to that tip, or we can say probe, is also defined. So the every probe has, it is a particular, you can say a particular probe type is required for particular scanning. So here we are using the scan assist mode. So the in the AF, so we have to choose a corresponding tip here. So the name is all already displayed in the library of Bruker. If it is not available, we can also manually put all these parameter of the scan assist tip. What is the length, width, spring constant, thickness? We can manually put all these things and create a one of the tip probe tip type. So here in the setup mode, we have to define only what is the probe we are using. Suppose we are using that tapping mode. In this case, we have to go for the tapping mode tip. It has a dedicated name defined by the manufacturing companies that is for the tapping, that like FESPA, TESPA, all these names are represented. So this is the only part here. As well as what is the cross pin, what I am discussing here, that we can change here, we can also change here. We can align as per your availability, as per your suitability, where you want to put here during the scanning. It is the only indication to identify that the tip or laser is aligning together or not, that is yours. But once you are expert in this AFM testing, then there is no need of this cross here. So this is the setup part. Now we'll come to the check parameters. So this is the check parameter part, and this is the main important parameter on which whole scan, and you can say what kind of scan we have to do. That means what size of the scan we have to use, and how much resolution we can achieve in this image, and what kind of the step size we can apply is defined in this check parameters window. So you can see here that first term is this part is here. The scan size is a 5 micron. We can use as per your availability, or you can say what is the parameter, what is the physical parameters or physical topography of the sample. If the feature size is very large, then we have to use a large scan size. That means a large area which have to scan. If the feature size is very small, suppose if we depose the ZnO nanoparticles or another nanoparticles, then we can use a 2 micron, 1 micron, 5 micron image. That is sufficient. For the high feature size, we have to go for the large scan area. So that is used to define the scan area. The aspect ratio, the same thing. X offset and Y offset. X offset and Y offset is similarly useful when we are going for the high resolution imaging. High resolution imaging means, suppose if you are going first, you are not aware about the morphology of this sample. So first you would have to check that what is the morphology of sample. So you randomly go for the 5 micron or 4 micron imaging. Then you see the what is the morphology here. So maybe if it is a nanoparticles, you are you will not be able to see the feature size, features of what is the features of the sample. So, but you can identify after 5 micron imaging that the features will be look like this. So now you can select one of the best particular area what is achieved in 5 micron scanning, 5 micron imaging. Then you can apply such kind of offset. Suppose you have a scan of such 5 micron scan area and you capture a very good image like in this image. You can see here in this image, suppose if you get this image, this area is very good area, and you want to capture from 5 micron image this area, then you can apply the offset in the X direction as well in the Y direction by these 2 points. So you can identify this. So we have one of the feature also here to provide this offset or Y set. That means we can select that particular short windows by zooming this area. So we can directly, we can also directly select, or we can also use this X offset and Y offset. Okay, this is the scan angle. The scan angle is basically generally the, if the scanner is moving in the X direction, that means it is moving in the you can say zero direction, 0 degree direction or 180 degree direction. If you are not getting a good morphology or good imaging from this pattern, then you can go to the normal scanning, or you can go to the any particular angled scanning. That means you can move scanner in this direction, you can move scanner in the 90 degree direction, you can move the scanner in the 60 degree, minus 60 direction, plus 60 direction, minus 40, plus 45, and 30, minus 30. So you can move the scanner in every direction and capture the image if it is getting a good image. So generally, if you are getting a good image in the horizontal direction, so there is no need to go into the vertical direction. And if you are not getting the good image in horizontal direction, then the single step to go into the vertical direction, you will get it, because the most of the artifacts will be removed in the vertical direction if attached to the tip. Okay, the third one is the scan rate. The scan rate is basically at what rate you want to scan that 5 micron imaging. Because we divide, before going to the scan rate, I will come here, sample per line. So this 5 micron image we divide into the lines. So when the Lestar pattern we are going to, in the Lestar pattern we are going to scan, as we discussed earlier, we will scan the Lestar pattern. So the whole 5 micron image will be divided in the lines, or you can say the complete sample of 5 micron image will be divided into the lines. So the lines we can choose as per your choice. It may be a 256, 512. So the how much lines you will use, it will take time to scan that particular area. So you can choose as per your availability. What once you will try to do an experiment on 256, 512, then you will get an idea that which one is suitable. So initially, if you start 256, then you will get one of the image, and 512, you will get an image. Then you will be able to see the difference between these two images. Okay, so maybe the resolution or the, you can say the imaging will be very good in case of the 512. Yes, time will be high in this case. So this sample, 5 micron image, is divided into the 256 lines, and these 256 lines is, you can say, these 256 lines we divide in steps, small steps. Then this is again your choice. You can divide these steps as per your choice. More number of steps, then more time will be taken is very high. So as we decide these two things, the scan rate will be your choice. Ideally, if you are going to the, depending upon the tip, what is the resonance frequency of that tip, scan rate, you can choose according to that. If it is the going to the higher scanning rate, in that case, you will go fast scanning. That means the frequency of tuning will be very high and you go for the fast scanning. And fast scanning, you will capture the image as early as compared to the slow scanning. So it is a scan rate. This is again your choice. But the same thing is here. Once you will try to do a scanning at particular rate and the another rate, you will see what is the difference. Okay. And these are the parameters which are automatically calculated or automatically done by the system in which mode we are using. In the scan assist mode, this is the same. If the image, one of the artifacts is there, if the image are not coming properly or we are not getting the image after keeping all these parameters, so there may be a one of the artifacts or there may be a one of the change will be required here in the feedback gain and the peak port set point. We have to try to change these and we have to see that what is the result is coming after doing the change of these. Okay. So this is the check parameter part. This is the important part. After this, the engaging. Engaging means when you have set all these points, all these parameters, then tip is to be aligned to the sample surface. If you are using in the contact mode, the soft touching will be there. And the non-contact mode, there will be a some little bit different distance between the sample as well as the tip. So engaging will be defined after setting all these parameters. So as we engage, then during the engage, the system will automatically rotate the Z axis of the scanner. That means the Z axis of the scanner will try to come closer to the tip and will stop at some little bit difference. If it is distance, if we are using a non-contact mode, and will go to the sum of the little bit Armstrong level if we are using contact mode. So the once the tip is completely engaged to the sample, then we go for the scanning. That is the fourth part, scanning. Before going to the fourth part, I will explain you a fifth part, that is the ramp. So ramp is exactly not needed in the scan assist mode. We go for the ramping. Ramping is generally to provide the ramp. The next one is the withdraw. Once the all the scanning of images complete and the image is coming perfect, then we can go for the withdraw. Withdraw means that means you are detaching the cantilever tip as well as the sample interaction. So we can go in the resting position and the left position. So here the scan part, that is the fourth part, is the scan part. So here I applied our same condition of 5 micron, zero offset, because I'm going to the first initial image capturing and then provide the scan rate of 250, scan rate of 1 hertz and the samples per lines and lines 256 by 256. So we start engaging. As the engaging complete, the automatically images, that means this cantilever, start to move 5 micron surface over the sample and we start to capture the image or what is the morphology or topographical information is present. Topographical information present over this 5 micron area we are capturing here. So this is the half part of the real-time capturing image. So you can see, say that one of the image we are getting here. So this is the height reference image. That means whether from the top of the sample, if we see, that is the what is the height of the sample surface is here, we can see. So this is the image, this is continuously arriving, and this is the part. If we see, this is the part, and this is the important part, or you can say a very concludable part to conclude or to alert you that if tip is engaged completely and scan is start, so the scan is start perfectly or not. If the scan is start perfectly, then you can say that these blue and red lines, these blue is the trace and the retrace. As I told you, then the scanner scan in the restar pattern. That means one of the restar tracing, another is the retracing. Tracing, retracing like this pattern. So this tracing and retracing would be almost overlapped to each other. So this is the one of the indication to you that what is the image you are capturing from after doing all these things, it is coming right or not. So if it is completely overlapping to each other, almost overlapping to each other, there may be a slightly difference because of the sample surface also, but almost will be touched, overlap to each other, then you can say that the image is coming perfect, so you can continue the imaging. So this is tracing and retracing. The same thing in the case of the non-contact mode, and the same in the another contact mode, and scan assist mode, and all types of mode. So these are the basic five, you can say, parameters which we have to set in every type of the mode which we are using. And if we set all these things properly, then we are able to get a good image. So once we get a good image, then we have to see what is the image we are capturing, what kind of image we are capturing, what is the particle size distribution over this, what is the particle size distribution in this image, what is the roughness of this image as a part of the result we can see from this. So now here the operation part is over of the sample. We can say that operation we have performed completely, and we have captured a very good image. And now we have to see that what kind of the information we can capture from this image. So the as we see that the AI, as we can see that AFM is a very good tool to find out the roughness, or you can say that AFM is a very good tool to capture the 3D image, which is not possible in the SEM and TEM. So the depth profiling we can also see by 3D image in AFM. So the what is the image we capture, we can see as a result of here. So you can see that is this part is the 2D image. So what is the 5 micron image we captured? I choose a very smooth or very good part over this 5 micron and capture a 2 micron image, and this is a 2 micron image. So you can see a distribution of you can say topographical information very clearly visible here. What is the particle distribution over this, you can see very, very visibly clearly here. We can see this in 2D diagram, 2D image, or as well as in the 3D image. So if we go for the 3D image, and we go for the you can say in the another view of 3D tilting, you can also see the what is the height, maximum height is there and minimum height there. If it is okay to you, I just show you one thing in the live if it is available. So if you see this kind of image, you can see in the every part of the corner, you can see the height as well as the height, what is the height we are getting in terms of the, you can say roughness, overall idea of the roughness you can see from here. And this is one of the image, and the what is the morphological information, and that in the single eye click you can see here. So we can also calculate the numerical value of all roughness as well as the particles size as well, particle distribution histograms we can see. So this in every angle of view we can see the maximum height what is present and the image is taken, and the depth of the image also. So this is the one of the information which we get from the AFM, that is in terms of the 2D and 3D. 3D phase diagram we can also capture, 2D diagram we can also capture. So the next part is the roughness. So generally many number of users use this AFM to calculate the roughness, because in the you can say in the lithographic process or nanolithographic process, if you are going for the masking and lithography process over any noble metal or any substrate, then if the roughness will be lower, then you can say the deposition will be perfect of the another layer. So that's why the roughness is important factor to find out. So roughness we can directly calculate what is the area we have to choose. In this case I choose the overall area, because you can calculate a good roughness value if you choose a maximum area, because the distribution, or you can say the sample morphology in the larger area can explain you the better roughness. If you use this three or four particles, you choose this area, there may be a difficult to say that this is your average roughness or maximum roughness. So it should try to catch a maximum part of the image or the maximum image so that you can calculate, you can go for the accurate roughness or precise roughness. So this is the roughness calculation. If we go for the this part, we can see that this is the icon here of roughness calculation, and this is the portion. You can go directly and select whatever the part of the image you want to select, because the morphological information, if I see in this image, this part has some of the feature and this part has another feature, so I would have to calculate the both part roughness, this part as well as this part also, and then overall calculation of the roughness. Then you can say that overall calculation of roughness is accurate because we are getting two type of the features. So this is the table where we can get a directly value of the roughness, R maximum if you required, R average value if you required, RMS required, we can capture. The another important thing is here, which generally people do in the SEM, calculation of the size of the particle. You can also see from here, and it may be provide a very good distribution, because the size we can calculate in the SEM, but the distribution, catching of distribution is little bit typical. So distribution we can from in the accurately. You can see in this image, when I select these 1, 2, 3, 4 part, four these four particles, and these are the bunches of some 2 or 3, and this is also some of bunches of 2 or 3. So you see that this is the one. So you can see this spectra is here, 1, 2. That means the two particles are joined here. The same thing is if I go to this, same 2 or 3 particles are also joined here. Here you can see 1, 2, 3 particles are attached. So 1, 2, 3 are attached here. And the 4 is here. That is a much bright because the height of the particle is very high as compared to these particles. So this thing. So these four particles, height distribution and the size distribution, you can see very clearly in this AFM. You can directly calculate because we have here a scale, or you can say scale paired. Once we put one of the scale here and one of the scale here, then when we can see what is the height of this. If we put here and here, then we can see the what is the size of this. If we go for the another image, you can see this. If I choose this portion, then you can see. So this is the some kind of the pattern is created of particle distribution. So I can easily see if I put this part is here, and this scale part is here, then I can see what is the vertical, the distance, and what is the size of this. Then the vertical distance means what is the depth, and what is the size of this. So I can see here is the what is the horizontal distance, that means 0.033 micron, and the vertical distance is a 6.1 nanometer. So you can easily calculate for the smaller particle, or you can say agglomerated particles in this AFM. So this is one of the best feature of AFM to gather it. So these was the common information which we can achieve from AFM. A part of this, we have a numerous of information we can get from the AFM. Suppose if you have created a step, that means suppose you have done any lithographic process on any chip, you can also find out the step height, what is the step height of that particular masking pattern. You can see from here depth analysis, we can the bearing analysis we can do. So most of the things we can do in the, if we are using another mode, suppose in the nano indentation mode or nano lithographic mode, in this case we can also capture some new information in terms of Young modulus, hardness of nano indentation case or nano lithographic case nano pattern. So number of applications or number of informations we can capture from the AFM single image. These are, now I come to the point of what is the problems we practically face during the scanning. So in which one of the common problem is that scanner non-linearity. canonominality means if you see this image, that means the image should become in proper pattern, but the image is slightly deflected in the particular direction. So this is the one of the common error generated due to the scanner. So we can say that means if we applied voltage to the scanner, because it is the piezoelectric, so we applied the voltage linearly or gradually to the scanner, so there may be a deflection or the change in the strain coefficient. So this should be a straight line. Ideally, this should be a straight line, but it is slightly deviated. When we increase the voltage, then the extension is increases. When we increase the voltage, this extension of the piezoelectric material is also increased, but it should be a straight line in ideal condition. And but in some cases, it is deviated from the straight line and created a stack of the pattern. So this del V, you can say that this del Y, sorry, this del Y deviated from this from its linear behavior. So this is called a scanner intrinsic non-linearity. So if we calculate this linearity, so we can directly go for the del Y, what is the linearity, and the what is the maximum deviation already present, del Y over on Y is the maximum deviation. Now the point is that how can we remove this scanner non-linearity? So one of the best answer of this question is that there may be a you can say that dipole movement of the scanner may be disturbed. Okay, so in this case, you have to just do one thing. You just keep off all the things, shut down the system, and after some time restart the system. So maybe a scanner will be realigned or the dipole movement will be perfect in this case, and start in the same condition again this image. Definitely you will get a good image. The second one is the creeping of the scanner. This is a generally these are the problems or these are the artifacts we generally face during the live practical applications. So first one is the very common. It generally faced in every type of the scanning or in if we are going for the 7 or 8 samples in a day, definitely you will face in the 1 or 2 samples. This is the creeping of a scanner. Creeping of a scanner means same as we applied the voltage to the scanner, PZT scanner, then piezoelectric reacts in the two patterns or two steps. Generally, it should be a single pattern. Because we are applying a digital pulse or discrete, single discrete pulse. So the behavior of the piezoelectric should be like in the single pulse. But it is disturbed. How it is disturbed? Because it is disturbed into the two parts. In two parts, one of the pattern is created in less than of the millisecond. But the second one part taker a much longer time. This part, second one part is the taker much a long time. This second part, that is the del Xc, is known as the creeping. This creeping causes what is the ideal time should be taken to scan a particular image. It is changed and it is increased. So this causes a image pattern is also disturbed. And suppose if a very small feature of the sample is present there, and due to this creeping, if it is coming to the at corner of that part of this image, due to the creeping, it will roll out to the scale. So this is one of the another scanning problem. The third one is the scanner aging. As I earlier told you that there is a regular use of the scanner is very important. If we are not using the scanner regularly, because the aging rate or you can say strain coefficient change in the piezoelectric PZT scanner is exponentially with time. So if we are not using the PZT scanner or you can say AFM in the routine pattern, then dipole movements of the scanners are disturbed, or there may be after a little bit time they are randomly aligned, so the resolution will be affected. So there is maybe a problem of resolution, or maybe you cannot get a good image. Definitely you will get the image, but not a good image. So similarly, if we are using the scanner continuously, due to the overage time, the dipole moment will again disturb, and it is diminishes after some time. So this is the scanner aging third. So these are the third things. These are the three basic things which we faced during the scanning. So these if I go into the short things, so in a short term, what is the scanning artifact? So scanning artifacts are present due to these four reasons or four or five reasons. There may be a various reasons, but the major reasons are highlighted here. That is, if the feedback is not good, that means if feedback is not provided properly to the scanner, then there may be a not a perfect scanning, because what is the cantilever movement will not be accurately measured due to the feedback loop, and image will be disturbed. The second one is electrical noise. So electrical noise, that means if we are not using the vibrating table or your isolation free table, that in this case, if we are doing AFM without office, then maybe a electrical, or that means a periodical noise of environmental or outer or internal noise signal will affect the scanning of image. Third one is the electrical noise. Electrical noise may be generated due to the internal signals leak, that means any leakage current due to the internal architecture of a feedback controller loop, or as well as we can say scanner. Due to the scanner internal architecture, there may be some leakage, there may be an electrical noise generated there, and scanning may be affected. Or unknown, third one is unknown, fourth one is unknown tip sample interaction. This unknown tip sample interaction is also affect scanning in daily routine basis, because if the, you can say, if the sample has a very non-regular pattern, not homogeneous, or you can say a pattern over the sample is not regular, in that case some of the particle at very high distance, some of it is a very low distance, so there will be a time to move to adjust the height by the scanner from the upper higher part to the lower part. So in that case the unknown tip sample interaction will be there, and image will be affected. So no good image will be appear. So these are the basic scanning artifacts which present. So we can, but we can avoid these artifacts by doing some taking care of attention and taking some precautions. So this is not a permanent type of the artifact. So this is a possible way by which we can remove this artifact. This is a generalized. This is a generalized way. If you are doing a daily basis, handling this daily basis, on daily basis this instrument, you can use, and you can use such type of the method and avoid, you can get a good image and avoid the artifact. So if you are getting some of the error during the scanning, then you can stop the scan and repeat the scan again. You will definitely get the looks. If you are not getting looks, then you can change the scanning angle. You can go for the 90 degree. If you are getting good image in the 90 degrees, perfect, not getting, you can change over the 60 degree, 45 degree, like this. If you are not getting again good image, there may be a chance that what is the scan size you have selected, that is the samples per line or lines what you have selected, you have to change that. If you are using maybe a lower number of lines and higher number of lines, it may be change your scanning image or scanning pattern, so you can change it. Next one is rotate the sample. So suppose what is the surface you are doing scanning at present moment, it is not providing a good image, then you can remove the cantilever holder, then change the position of sample over the scanner and retaking the image. There may be a chance, then you can get a good image. Scan speed. Yeah, scan speed is also very important. Scan speed is important in some bulk samples which has a very high roughness, because due to the high roughness, movement of the tip over the samples, these high roughness samples can be damaged tip or contaminate the tip surface, because generally it happens. So in this case, if you go for the very high speed scanning, so number of chances will be there, high number of chances will be there, then your probe can be damaged or probe can be damaged. So in this case, you have to adjust the scan speed. You go for the low speed so that you can save both things. Thanks. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. And yes, this facility is also, our AFM facility is also available on the iSnap. So you can avail this device.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the very good presentation. It was very well presented, very informative. So we have few questions in the chat box. 1 minute. Okay. Could you explain major significance of AFM compared to SEM from Thirumalai Kumar R? This was a question asked.
Yes. If we go for the comparison between the AFM and SEM, the principle, first thing is the principle of both is different. In the SEM, you are using the electron beam. That is the source of incident or the, you can say, source of scanning over the sample. While in the AFM, you are using a probe, cantilever tip probe phenomena. So the principle of both things are different. Second thing, the AFM does not require any sample preparation. Okay. While the SEM, if you go for the SEM, if it is a conducting sample or non-conducting sample, if it is a non-conducting sample, you require a coating of conducting material, either gold or any other material. But in the case of the AFM, it is not necessary. We can go for the semiconductor material, insulating material, as well as the conducting materials also. Yeah, resolution terms. Resolution is very high. You can go to the nanoscale level as compared to the SEM. So SEM has a limited resolution, line is called line resolution and the point resolution. So many of the difference or comparison is available. AFM, you can go for the relative cost as well. If you go for the economical point of view, cost is very high in the SEM, while in the AFM is not so much. Time for imaging in the SEM is one of the advantages. In the SEM, we can capture an image in the very short period of time, while in the AFM, we cannot get. If the image is not coming properly, then we have to go for rerun. So it may take 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, or 1 hour also to get one perfect particular image. So these are the basic difference.
Yeah, thank you, Tesh. Now we'll come to the next question. So what will be the approx cost of an AFM?
It depends upon what kind of feature you want to include in your system. Suppose if you are going for the only AFM microscopy, like as you want to do only a contact mode, non-contact mode, and tapping mode scanning, then the cost may be around of 60 to 70 lakhs. If you are going to the sum of the mode included, it depends upon the variation of from different manufacturers. And generally, I'm talking about generalized specification and generalized costing. So if you are going for the some specific features, like suppose if you want to end a nano intendation, nano lithography, scanning tunneling microscope, magnetic force microscope, the corresponding cost is also increased. It may be go to above the 1 crore. So it depends upon what kind of the modes you want to use here. So base price will start from the 60 to 70 lakhs by which we can do for only a imaging purpose.
Okay, thank you. Sir, next question. Yes, okay.
Sir, in MNIT, in your AFM, is nano intendation possible?
Yes, possible, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
We have next question from the Ashutosh Dubey. So, which mode of AFM is required for graphene oxide and the graphene oxide based metal composite material?
So if this is in the powder form, it is not possible to go for the AFM our system. So we have to create a thin film of this. So if this graphene powder is dispersible in any liquid solution, then we can go to create a thin film of this by using this liquid dispersible solution and drop cast over the glass slide over or the silicon substrate. Then we can do AFM. So best possible image we can capture, because it is in the hard, maybe a hard material. If it is a hard, completely hard and dry, then we can go for the contact or scan assist mode. If it is not, then we can go for the tapping mode. So the most of the cases we can directly go for the tapping mode.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, please.
Yeah. I'm Dr. Mohammad Ashraf Khan. Yeah, I have one little bit of query, a little bit of confusion regarding this. Because in electron microscopy, we are using electrons, no, as source. Here we are using light. Then how come we are saying that AFM has more resolution as compared to electron microscopy? Because there we can get more details, no, about the sample. Because the resolution of electron, if we see, it is a half the wavelength of the electron. So if we consider that, the resolution of electron microscopy should be better, no?
No, in terms of the resolution, not is the overall resolution. Suppose if you are going to scan a 5-micron image.
Okay.
Suppose if you are going to a 5-micron image, and this 5-micron by 5-micron image you have divided into 256 lines of scanning. Mm-hmm. Okay, so 256 line of scanning you have divided this. So the resolution of this image, 5-micron by 5-micron image, you can determine by 5 divided by 256 to some of the angstrom level. So that means the feature size you can see here to the angstrom level, not the overall resolution which we are comparing here. That the in the case of the SEM, yes, obviously SEM has a good resolution, but the what is the image you are capturing, we are talking about that particular resolution, we can go to the angstrom level.
Yeah, in that way it is okay. Yeah, otherwise I was talking of that resolution. Fine.
Nah, obviously the SEM is perfect, sir.
Yes.
Good evening, sir. Am I audible? Yes, sir, madam. Very nice presentation and very informative presentation. Sir, my doubt is that if the sample is ceramics, it is better to we go for a contact mode or non-contact or tapering mode.
Yeah, it depends upon also this, what is the surface roughness. If the roughness is very high, if it is going to around more than 100 nanometer or 200 nanometer, then the contact mode will be not preferable in that case. So I think in this case you should use the tapping mode.
Okay, sir. How do we know the roughness of something? If you have any idea,
generally, if you have a synthesis your own ceramic sample, then by optical microscopic, you can see the top surface morphology of the sample. It can create an idea that what should be the roughness. Not provide the exact numerical information about the roughness, but it provide you an idea that what is the roughness of the sample. So we can go accordingly, adding an approximate idea, because we can see if you go for the solid sample, one of the solid sample, suppose ceramic solid sample you have in your hand, okay, and the one of the thin film deposited on the maybe a glass slide, because glass is also a little bit rough, so glass slide. So we can see that the solid sample, solid ceramic has a little bit high roughness as compared to the glass. So we can already predict that maybe a roughness of this. And then we can go accordingly. If you do not know about the roughness, then directly go for the tapping mode.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. So we'll come to the next question. It is the sample thickness required for AFM, SEM, and TEM. It's asked by the professor, Dr. T.R. Vijayaram.
Please, would you repeat question, ma'am?
Yeah, the sample thickness required for AFM. I think he wants to ask the minimum thickness required for AFM.
Yeah, minimum thickness which can you prepare is okay for the AFM. Generally, we prefer 0.5 mm or 1 mm thickness. Okay, because I think beyond this, if we go for the AFM, it is very difficult to prepare the sample. So 1 mm is okay. We can go for the AFM. In the case of the SEM, this is again also okay, thickness-wise. Larger thickness can also be used in the case of the SEM. But in the case of the TEM, this thickness is not perfect because electron transmitted throughout the sample. So in this case, we have to go a thickness less than 100 nanometers because we have to throughout the electron beam through the sample. So if we are using the powder or liquid sample, then it is directly broadcast on the copper grid. If you are having a solid sample, then you have to create a thickness of this less than 100 nanometer.
Okay, thank you. We have next question from the Shruti KN. And I would request you to, Shruti ma'am, can you just directly ask your question? Her question is like, she has 1 micrometer, 4 micrometer, 10 and the 20. I think it's micrometer, no? Right? The images of polymer nano composite samples. So which one is good to use? So ma'am, as your question is not very clear, like what is the application and where, what kind of images these are?
Yeah, so but I got, start. I got her point. I got okay. her point. Yes. Actually, as per my opinion, you have a 4-scale image of 1 micron or a 4 micron, 10 micron and 20 micron, I think. And you have a polymer sample. In this yes. case, what happened? Actually, polymer samples does not provide any information in the nanoscale level time. So the polymer, if you want to see a complete feature of your polymer sample, in this case, you would have to go on large scale. So that's why you capture the 20 micron image. Otherwise, there is no need of the 20 or 10 micron image. And you capture 10 or 20 micron image because you need this image because the feature of your sample, complete feature of your sample will be visible in that 20 micron image or 10 micron image. So you would have to analyze if it is available complete feature in 10 micron image, then you can use this image, otherwise in 20 micron image, if it is perfectly captured. Okay.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Yeah. We have another question from the Shruti. Like, what is the significance of increase in roughness of polymer nano composite materials while increasing the doping concentration?
No, in terms of AFM, if you are discussing about it, if you are discussing about a synthesis basis, so the significance depends upon material to material or what is the application you are using. If you are discussing about the AFM point of view, then the roughness we cannot increase in AFM. We can measure the roughness through AFM. So there is no concept of increasing or decreasing the roughness through the AFM. What, if we are discussing about the synthesis of material, it will really depend upon the what is the application. If the suppose if you are using the one of the energy harvesters, like as a triboelectric energy harvesters, one of the energy harvesters is there. In the case roughness as much as high, then the response of triboelectric energy harvester will be very, 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 very good. If the roughness is lower, then the performance is very poor. So this is one of the kind. And another kind, if you are going for the nanoparticle deposition, you are going for the sensor applications, the roughness should be minimum. Otherwise, there may be a chance that you cannot deposit the another layer perfectly over the base layer.
Hello?
So it will depend upon application to application. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. We are still open for the question answer session. So if you have any questions, you can directly ask.
Hello, Hiteshi.
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to ask a related question. Since you mentioned this roughness is area dependent, right? And if we take a bigger area, the roughness will be more, right? So generally when people report, they report RMS roughness, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Does this, when we report RMS roughness, then does it take care of the area? Like, is it like that or
yes.
something else?
Yes, but I will actually, what happened in these cases, I will suggest you to use the R maximum. If you really want to report in the articles, you should use the RMS value and cover the maximum portion. Generally, people use the RMS who do not have same roughness over all the area. Mm-hmm. In some part, they have another kind of the morphology, and some part have another kind of morphology, another type of the pattern and roughness. So they use the RMS values. But if you want to calculate overall roughness, it will be a significant to report that the roughness of my sample is this.
But one more thing is, like, it is area dependent as well. Suppose I'm scanning a 10 by 10 micron area and a 2 micron area, the both roughnesses will be different, I think, right?
No, if the morphology in 10 micron image, whatever the 10 micron image you have captured, it is showing the same morphology as you captured 5 micron image, there may be a not so much difference in the roughness.
Okay, fine.
If the morphology is different, because the at every place of the sample, we cannot expect same type of the morphology if we, it is not thin film, if it is not deposited by sputtering PVD, then maybe a chance deposition of the film or distribution of the particle is not uniform over the entire surface of sample. So there may be a chance you're getting a 10 micron image, there may be a chance ki, you are getting a different kind of morphology. If you are going for the 5 micron images there, there may be a chance you can just getting a different
Morphology. Even if we have the same morphology, suppose we have a 10 micron area, we'll have more number of grains and number more porosity if we have porous film. So, and in lesser area, we'll have lesser number of grains and less like porosity will be same, but number of grains will be different. So the roughness will also be like different, it seems, no?
No, actually roughness also depend upon the area. So roughness will not change in this case because the area you have also minimized. So the calculation of the roughness will be based on the area. So whatever the area you have minimized, the overall roughness will also be changed.
Okay. Okay. Fine. So, and then we should report R maximum only.
Yeah, it should be beneficial to you if you report this.
Sure, sure. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Hello.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Anyone else has any questions?
Yes, madam. Sorry. Yes, madam.
Hello. Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, because now this session was supposed to be at up to 4:30. No, already it is 5:30. We have some other works as well, no, the online class and other things. I think if it is better to let's close it now, because already it is 1 hour late. No, otherwise, can you please give us the permission? We can leave the meeting because we have the other assignments as well. No, it was up to 4:30. Now it is already 1 hour late.
Sir, my side, one small request, sir. Would you like to be share this PPT, sir, with our email or other more?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, we also have this YouTube recording which can be viewed in iSTEM India page. I can go through that as well.
One more question I want to.
Okay, madam. Okay. Thank you, madam.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, sir. You have told, I am Ashutosh Dubey of Nanosciences, Central University of Gujarat. Sir, you have told for graphene oxide and composite material, you have to prepare, they are in powder form, so you have to prepare, disperse it. That means I have to disperse in water, they are water dispersible. So how much concentration is required for that 0.20, like TEM, we are low concentration is required and we are drop casting on the copper grid. So what
if you, it is not a particular concentration is required, but in the case of the AFM, if you are going to prepare any powder sample into the thin film form, you should use a minimum concentration of the sample and the maximum concentration of the what is the dispersible solution you are using. Okay.
0.2 mg per ml or 3 mg, low concentration is required, or for example, the graphene oxide based composite material. 0.2, 0.3 or intermediate concentration?
No. You cannot say about the number that 2 mg per ml is required. You have to go for the Hatton trial run. Okay. So you have to go for the 1 mg per ml, 2 mg per ml Hatton trials. So what is the better results you can obtain, you can go for that particular concentration.
Generally, sir, we have to take
0.2 to 0.3. Yes, I'm saying less concentration of your sample, less quantity of your sample will perform the better result.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
One more question, sir.
Yeah.
If we compare the AFM with the profilo, the 3D profilometer, then who will give the better result?
3D optical profilometer or 3D?
We have 3D optical profilometer. Profilometer. Yeah. I'm actually speaking from IIT Roorkee. We have 3D optical profilometer. I have not worked on the AFM because my all the work I can perform on the yeah. But I am just for the sake of information. I'm just asking whether if I compare the then but which one gives the better results?
If you compare in terms of the resolution, in terms of the image processing, the definitely
image AFM processing and resolution as well.
AFM is perfect as compared to the optical profilometer.
AFM is better?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess there are no more questions to be asked. So thank you for a very wonderful presentation, sir. So let's end the session. Shweta, shall we end the session?
Yes, sure. And once again, Hitesh, thanks a lot for this informative session.
Yeah, you're welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.